Welcome again to another edition of Whiteboard Wednesday. In today's edition, you're going to hear first from Bill Caskey, who's going to talk to you a little bit about what it's like to be a buyer versus a seller. He's going to tell you about a real deal where he was the buyer, and you're going to have to wait and find out whether he bought or whether he didn't buy, and why or why not. You're also going to hear from Brooke Green today. Brooke's going to talk about a deal that she actually lost. It's her first deal in 4 years that she's lost. But she's going to tell you some things and some issues that came up in that deal that really taught her some really valuable lessons that I think you're going to find valuable too. And also Bill and myself are going to go through a mailbag segment. We're actually going to answer your questions that you've sent us over the last few weeks. As I watched Bill and Brooke's segment, there were a couple things that jumped out at me that I thought would be really helpful to have to you to pull out first of all before you got into today's episodes. The first thing is, I want you to think about the idea of paying attention. You'll see both when Bill and Brooke talk to you about what happened to them, part of what they learned came from the fact that they were paying attention to what was going on around them. There are instances every day where you can pay attention to what's going on around you, whether you're at the grocery store, talking to your spouse, or listening to another conversation between two business people. There is always something to learn when you pay attention to how two human beings interact. The second thing that I will tell you is that in the end, and you're going to hear this both from Bill and from Brooke today, is the answer is almost always about getting your mind right. Getting your mind right seems to be the answer to so many things and so many problems that we have. You're going to hear in Bill's example, and in Brooke's example, and even in a couple of the mailbag examples that you ask us, that the answer is typically in something to do with your thinking, not in what you're saying or what you're doing. Enjoy this episode of Whiteboard Wednesday.
About a week ago, I called a business service here locally up because I needed some help with something. And they sent a salesperson out. He was a really nice guy, really liked him. But after he left, I didn't buy from him. And it was kind of, at the end, it was just kind of frustrating. And I was trying to think to myself, what was there about the call that didn't go right? And of course, we're here to help you, teach you a little bit about sales and approach and communication. So it's always interesting when we get called on, what happened. And the more I thought about it, the more I found that he was at cross purposes with me. My purpose was to find out about the service and to be able to determine whether I had a problem that he could solve. His purpose was to sell me something. So when his purpose and my purpose crossed, we ended up having no deal. He lost because he didn't get my money. I lost because I never got a solution to my problem, which I still have, by the way. So I think the lesson there for us is when you go in to sell someone and you're there, your intention and your purpose is to convince them, you will be at cross purposes with them. Here's a better strategy, better technique. Make sure that when you're there for the same reason that they think you're there. Find out what their issues are, what their pains are. Your purpose should be exactly the same as theirs to understand whether they have a problem worth solving. And the frustrating part is, as a buyer, I never got my problem solved and still haven't. And it was all because he showed up with the wrong purpose.
Do you guys ever feel like after you've been doing your business for a while that it's getting a little stale or you need to gussy it up a bit? I was feeling like this recently and tried to get real flashy and kind of lost sight of some of the basic things that you really start to take for granted that are really what your value is to your prospect. What happened to me is I actually ended up losing a deal because of it. So I'm going to tell you a little bit of the story so you can learn from my loss. I had met with a gentleman several times about training his team. We had great conversations. He had a good team of people and I felt like I could help them, and he really was thinking that I would be the one that could help them. So I put together a recommendation and really thought in my head, man, this is going to be great. We're going to move forward. And come to find out, I did not get the deal. So let me tell you what I did. Because it was a pretty basic training package, because training is what we do, that didn't seem like enough to me, even though in our conversations he had said to me, my people need the basics. They need to just get started. They've never done training before. I'm not even sure how they're going to take it. We need fast results. We don't have time for, you know, stuff that's going to take months for them to catch on to. So I really just need some basic stuff. And while I heard all that, that didn't seem very exciting to me. So I tried to sex it up a little bit, I guess. And I made this great recommendation. And I had all these bells and whistles in it. And unfortunately, when he read it, I totally didn't listen to what he said. And we all know nobody likes to feel like they're not being heard. And he used this analogy with me. We were talking, we went to lunch afterwards because I always like to learn from deals that I lose and just find out what I did that didn't click. And we were talking about football, and the NFL teams are going back into training camp, and he asked me a great question. He said, you know, the Colts are going back into training camp, and even though those guys have talent beyond measure and can do amazing things, what are they working on in training camp right now? And I said, well, they're working on the basics, blocking, tackling, and he said, exactly. They never stop working on the foundational things, the things that make them good to begin with. And that hit so home for me, because I think all of us start to take for granted the foundational things that make us great, that allow us to do all of the really fancy, miraculous stuff at some points in our business life. So I'm not saying to let your business get stagnant and to stop working on it, but as you improve it and try to do different things, never lose sight of the foundational stuff that made you great to begin with.
Day, correct?
It is mailbag day.
So you've got a couple of letters for us.
You want to get right to business today, I see. Okay. I've got a question that a client asked me, and I'm going to ask it to you, and okay. Then you've got a client that asked you
correct.
This question. So here we go.
Go ahead.
So Bryan,
yeah.
Smarty Pants.
Yes.
How do I handle it when my company has screwed up and the customer is mad at me?
Oh.
So it doesn't matter what it is,
happens.
I guess.
No,
it
just, no, yeah. How do I handle it when my company has screwed up and
yeah.
my customers are mad at me? Okay, so a couple of just general thoughts here. And here's what I find occurs with clients. First, we'll start with the mental game, the inner game thing.
Yep.
We always start first,
yep.
right? The first part is we've got to get to a place where we feel comfortable. I use this in the refereeing business sometimes. I say to myself, they're mad at the shirt. They're not mad at me. They're yelling at the shirt. They're not mad at me. So as you're
they
thinking
love
about that,
me.
Think of that little,
shirt
yeah, they love me. It's just this black and white striped shirt they don't like. And so that's first and foremost, they're probably not really mad at the salesperson. They're mad at the situation.
At the situation. Yeah.
You're just the receiver of that anger or that frustration, whatever that is. So you got to first get mentally okay with that before you go into the scenario. Second thing then is you have got to come clean. We talk about, if you think about over here being real positive about something, over here being real negative about something, you know, in the sales scenario, usually people start in the middle and then they come over here to positive and they buy.
Mm-hmm.
Then they get upset because we screw something up and they go way back here mm-hmm. to negative. We've got to make sure that as we dialogue with them, that we go back there with them.
Yeah.
We can't come in and cover up, make excuses, blame, those sorts of things. We've got to come clean, be real authentic, real vulnerable and say, we totally blew it,
yeah.
we kicked it. And then come back with some ideas or solutions on how to make it better.
And even if you acknowledge that if I were in your position, I would be equally as upset, is
yeah.
not a bad thing. But you got to really feel that way. It can't just be a move that you make to
right.
try to
right. Yeah. The
solve
only other
it.
Caveat that I see salespeople do sometimes is they want to skirt the issue from themselves, and
yeah.
they want to say, gosh, our customer service people told me that this
not
was shipping
my problem,
and they weren't.
Yeah,
yeah they, gosh, you know, our my production staff told me that we had this in stock and now we don't, so let me call them and see what they say.
Yeah.
We blame it on someone else internally. Don't do that. I think that puts you in a really
yeah.
weak position, and it tells something to the customer that our company as a whole is screwed up.
Yeah.
It doesn't send a good message.
So the lesson there is come clean,
yes.
acknowledge the truth,
yes.
be empathetic,
yeah.
don't defend, and call it what it is and bring solutions, bring remedies.
Yeah. Yeah, and yeah. they're yelling at the shirt. They're not yelling
they're
at
not
me.
They're not yelling at you. Yeah,
there
okay.
You,
you want to take mine?
Yeah, can
all
I
right.
just read it here?
You bet. You bet.
This says, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Bill, for $50,000.
Let me put my thinking cap on here.
What if I sell a product where there is no apparent pain? Customers just continue to chug along with oblivious to pain. How do I sell to that? When my customers are just chugging along, they're oblivious to pains and problems of how great their life could be mm-hmm. if they just bought whatever it is that I sell, but they're not even open to seeing me.
Yeah.
How can I sell to that?
Wow.
And it says Smarty Pants here, but I'm not going to go.
You're not going to say that, yeah. It's kind of odd. Yeah, really, in a way, doesn't every sales situation reflect a little bit of this? I mean, you are here to sell something. The prospect is not calling you, begging you for it. So in some way, you have to interrupt them in their daydream of life and get in to have a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
This came from a client who was struggling with this, and it's in the medical profession, healthcare profession, where everything is topsy-turvy anyway.
Right.
I've been wanting to use that word for
topsy-turvy.
A long time, topsy-turvy. But the point is that you have to really have a compelling message or you're not going to get in. You're not going to even have the discussion.
Yeah.
So here's the advice I gave them, and for good, for better or for worse, they haven't tried it yet, so if it didn't work, you'll never hear about it again. But I said, who is the constituent that you're really wanting to address? And in this case, it was the office manager or the practice administrator. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, if you were going to write a letter to the office office manager or practice administrator, what would be the headline of the letter? And one of the guys on the phone, very bright guy, says, well, the headline of the letter is, are you getting paid what you deserve when you deserve, meaning your practice? And I said, okay, you have just written a fantastic headline. I said, what's the subhead to that? And we talked a little bit about it, and we came up with, usually people make mistakes. And they make mistakes because they're not really attuned to what other options and possibilities are out there. So the subhead became three mistakes most small practices make when they fail to investigate X. Mm-hmm. And so now we have attention, practice administrator, office manager, which is going to get their attention.
Yep.
You have the headline that causes me to at least read the subhead, and the subhead, three mistakes that most practices make. I might even be offended by three mistakes, but I have to read it because I want to know if I'm making those mistakes.
Yep.
And then the mistakes they talked about in this article or in this email addressed issues that their competition does not pick up on that they do. And it's framed not in terms of a feature or a benefit, but in terms of a problem. So in other words, if my competitor doesn't have these to ship with the product, what's the problem of not having these? Well, the problem is I don't get a chance to display these on your desk, and my ego takes a hit, and I don't have a nice surrounding. These technically is not a good example. But the point is, what do you offer that your competition doesn't, and turn it into pain, turn it into a problem?
Very, very good.
All right. Good.
Do you want to react to that?
Did I react to yours? Yeah, you can react because I reacted to yours.
Yeah, the only thing, I'm not going to add to it necessarily, perhaps enhance it, is in the words of the immortal Jim Valvano, don't give up, don't ever give up. Yeah. Meaning, these clients, over and over and over, once they hear messaging like you're talking about, will start to break free. They'll start to loosen up. They'll start be more open. People want to just leave a message and say, can I come talk to you about what we do?
Right.
Can I come talk to you about what we do? And that's it. And then it doesn't work. And they just stop.
Yeah.
Or something like that. So change it up. Change the frequency. Change the cadence. Change the message. But don't ever give up with this. There's a persistence element to it that I think will serve them well in the long run.
You know who else said don't give up, don't ever, ever, ever give up?
I don't.
Winston Churchill.
Did he really?
Also said, ending a sentence with a preposition is something up with which I will not put. Two B's next time.